The key is to be able to be self-analytical, step back and be your own biggest critic. The casting process is one-on-one. I'd never have a committee there, ever, ever. Bad for the actor. And so usually it's me and a casting director, that's it. Mm-hmm. And sometimes certain casting directors, so she says, you want me there? I said, not really. Oh, if I'm going to have to read, then I'll have another actor there to read with them. I would never read with an actor because, first of all, I want to watch them. I want to hear them. I don't want to worry about what I'm doing because otherwise I'm suddenly auditioning for this actor who's rolling his eyeballs saying this guy can't read, right? I think, no, it's very private that, and then when there are producers other than myself involved, to be polite, I will then say, I thought of so-and-so, so-and-so, and so-and-so, what do you think? And they go, okay. Like, if it's a high-end project like Gladiator, where Walter Parks asked me in, and there's Stephen, and that's it, really. Then, of course, I go through the process, and I'm very polite in the process, and therefore they will see tapes of what I've done. And then we'll get into the discussion where, you know, they'll say something or not. Or say, jolly good, or we think that one. And I'll say, I like that one. And I say, well, we got to go back again, I'll do it again. But on a film like Gladiator, I could have put those tests into the film. Because what I did, because it's such a hard press, push, to hit those old toga and sandal jobs, you know, that I don't want a guy standing in a T-shirt reading, you know, the scene with the four virtues. Like, Joaquin, for me, was always my intuition. Joaquin for Commodus would be great. They couldn't see it, so I had to test him. So I said, fair enough. So, and Oliver Reed, they thought he was kind of gone, gaga. And I had to test Ollie, right, because it was fine. But Joaquin, it was good because it was a useful time because Janti had just done this beautiful breastplate and black shirt, and so there's Joaquin standing there and his breastplate and his Marlboro cigars, almost catatonic with terror. As soon as he put the costume on, he nearly fainted. He couldn't believe it. There's no way I can cope with this, mate. And you really light it and you really sell him. Never undersell that tape, because you see some shitty casting tapes where they look terrible, they sound terrible, and frankly, it's worth the effort of doing this properly, because you got an actor coming in, that's all you're going to get. And I see some of the worst casting tapes saying, who did this? Who sent this? You know, get a piece of sound equipment, because you want to hear the actor, I can't hear the actor, I want to hear traffic. I want to find out. Mm-hmm. I want to find out right there what they can, who, you know, as much as I can, what they're made of. And but that will first of all be a long chat, and then they'll go away. I'll think about it. Then I'll basically they'll be called, recalled to come in and read. So they'll be given. I say, look, there's three scenes. Choose two, your choice. What do you want me to do? I say, I don't know. I want you to do it. You show me. I want to see how they think. I want to see how good their taste is.
Do you let the actor, when you're doing a scene, choose the way they move around the set, or do you do?
I've tried every which way. And I worked with one star, I said, God damn it, really, you can't tell me everything you're doing in the fucking room. And I said, okay, fine, I'll sit here and I'll watch you guys. Ready? Action. It ended up with the two guys standing in the middle of the room talking to each other. And I said, that's really interesting, Michael. And to be nice about him, he turned around and burst out laughing and said, you're absolutely right, what do you want us to do?
So is that all part of your pre-planning, how you want them to move within your shot?
I think a scene's in like three dimension. Mm-hmm. I think of moving objects in a space, mm-hmm. right? And that's linked to, not the visual, it's linked to the script. Mm. So I guess I must think about what would I do. So I will always put myself in the place of that actor. Oh, the character, not the actor, the character. So I tend to think about that. What would I do when I come in here if I've got this syndrome of dealing with now in Matchstick Men? How does he get up? First thing I do is say him get up in the morning, mm-hmm. just to get out to work as a major, right? And so I will have to obviously think through that as to what I'd do. Then discuss it, and then he'll say, no, I'd do that, okay. And you gradually build. You gradually build. Then it solidifies, and you say, you cool with that? I'm cool with that, okay. And that will happen across the table. then dialogue will be read across the table in a room with, I rarely do what they call the big read. I think they're an absolute waste of time. Unless you've got something that's end on end, like a good play. But you know, films are so much about the space that, and I remember we had a read on Gladiator, it was an absolute disaster. Where Russell started reading, you know, Maximus in a Mickey Mouse voice, like I just fucking socked him. And he just didn't want to do it. And because we'd kept dear old Oliver Reed waiting, he'd got 2 pints of beer, so he was long gone. And there's this giant room, conference room, with all these people. And I said, we shouldn't do it. You're talking about a 2.5 hour film? You're going to read it? We're going to be here for 6 hours. It's exhausting. And what I feel most of all about is the poor spear carrier down the end there, who's got 3 lines, and he, in the 5th hour, he's like nodding off, and somebody's going to say, now, now, this is your big chance. And I feel, so it's completely counterproductive. I think it's far more productive getting the keys together in their key scenes. You talk, read through, I can't say this is too long, I don't like that. And getting all that out the way, right? And then, in fact, what I'm doing on Matchstick, I think, is when the script is finally in, which is now, where Ted's tightened a bit. It's tricky because the script's so good. It's 136 pages, it's great. But tightened, and I said, what we're going to do is, I'm going to get Debbie Zane to give me 2 of her favorite readers. We'll sit at the table, and I'm going to read the whole bloody film on tape. So what you're going to do is listen to like a radio play, because I was, and you don't have radio players here anymore, but BBC still occasionally have none, but I never listen to them. But BBC Drama used to have BBC Drama on the third program, and you'd get plays on there with sound effects of doorknobs and footsteps and things like that. And it was a very visual experience, because you're sitting there at night listening to sound radio, and the best screening room in the world is working in here. And so you can hear the key elements of the film, all the dialogue, end to end. And you can say, God, this is endless, that's too long, this is too, I've heard that before. And you literally, they're just sitting, listening to the radio play, making notes. Because when you hear it, you know, reasonably or quite well read, you're suddenly seeing where you want to put the brakes on, loose things. So that 4-page scene is, God almighty, it's running 6 minutes. We can't have that. And so you address your problems, right? Never done. Actors, something, Al Pacino does that a lot. He tries to get all his buddies around a table. He's about to do a film. He gets some of his buddies in and they read, sit there and read. So he hears the film very often before he commits.
It's amazing how many writers don't ever hear the work, and they're sitting there writing pages and pages of dialogue and never listen to a voice articulate it.
But you know, I think, I mean, let's only really talk about good writers, whether they're experienced or inexperienced. I think a good writer has, and sometimes I wish I was a good writer, because a good writer has already made the film in his head. Mm-hmm. He sat there and made the film in his head. So in a sense, he feels he's made the film. And therefore, he's heard the voices.
Well, you have to hear them, but then there's also, hear different characters through their voices. But it does make a difference. You do hear a lot of different other things when you hear it out loud.
Sure. Or something you hadn't thought of.
Yeah. Do you do rehearsals offset at all before you go into production?
Well, walking around rooms, no.
No.
I mean, I do it, I did enough of that in the church halls at BBC. So. I'll tend to do a lot at the table, and then when we hit the floor, whether it's location or the studio, first thing in the morning I walk them around, just say, before, you know, they stand there wondering how they got there with a cup of coffee in their hand, right? And I say, right, walk, you know, bring him here, and walk, right, this is your living room, da da da, and look around, get used to it. And then say, right, should I launch in, or would you like to launch in? And usually they say, okay, let's hear it. So I say, right, what I thought was blah, blah, blah. And I think if you're moving forward with confidence and you're not entirely moronic,
director.
I find very little questioning. They just say, that sounds good. say, right, how long? Hour and a half makeup, you know, right, get them made up, mm-hmm. give them breakfast, walk them back in here grinning. Mm-hmm. And then we'll then start to hit. I'd probably do enough rehearsal for them to feel happy mm-hmm. having saved it. I don't want to see it. I just want them to be going through, I'm talking. I'd rather hear it flat. Mm-hmm. And then he says, oh, okay. I said, okay, we're going to shoot, and because it's only celluloid. But as soon as you go right standby, that's the first time it starts to really get serious. Until then, you're screwing around. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing I hate more than seeing a great rehearsal, and they did it, and I wasn't filming. Mm-hmm. That drives me crazy. I go, oh, God. Because then you then spend 30 takes trying to get back to what you thought you didn't get. And so I tend to film almost immediately. Mm-hmm. And they go, but you can't do it. They go ashen, saying, what's the difference? We're all friends. It's celluloid. If you're wrong, I don't care. Mm-hmm. But there may be something about it which, even with some errors, which could be fantastic. So,
well, that's part of the trust then that they feel.
Oh, yeah. And I think that's why I nearly was trying to work two cameras. Because if I've got one camera flying this way and it's great, and I don't get it this way, God damn it, and he made a mistake, but it was wonderful, then I've got to then try and correct it artificially this way. Uh-huh. So I try wherever I can, whether it doesn't compromise the lighting too much, and I know a lot about lighting, where I try and always work two cameras, even handheld.
Yeah, that's great.
Yeah.